just in case, because sometimes you see the title Vice President, you might think I'm an end user guy, not set up businesses. Yeah, I set up my first business when I was 25. That was just last year. Sorry guys, it was probably about 15 years ago. Alright, so I'm responsible for the Asia Pacific business of consulting group, and that covers about 14 countries. So I get to engage with talent, people, different cultures, different sets of complexities, starting from Asia and then probably across all the markets. So we are in the people business. We call it workforce solutions. And when you are in workforce solutions, it's all about making sure you have the right people. Right people who will make sure that the right things happen for you at the right time and help you drive or grow the business. A lot of people say ideation process is key for entrepreneurs. Is that a roadmap? Having a perfect ideation process, generating an idea, make it commercially viable, but will that take you far? Yes? No? Doesn't matter. So how many of you are already entrepreneurs here? Okay, good. And the rest? Coming to you? Started thinking about it? Okay, probably after the session you might have some interest around it. So the objective of this session is today to encourage entrepreneurs to go beyond just ideation as well, but also look at how talent plays an equal impact on ideation. So I've summarized a couple of things which I'm going to share with you. We call it the 101 of talent. Okay, 101 of talent, or the fundamental areas of talent. We also want to make sure that this knowledge which I'm going to share with you, it's not magic because I've got only 1 hour. I'm hoping that I can give you as much information, but we will progressively add more experience and knowledge over the time. But before I start, what is your objective out of this session? What would you like to take away? Experience. Okay? Share with you right away after this. Anything else? Importance of talent as you're starting up. Because startup is first step, right? Then building, accelerating, growth. Different stages require different type of talent. Right? I'm also going to share with you something about the entrepreneurs I work with. I work with a lot of family businesses, the chairman and the CEOs, who have difficulty in letting go. Right? They want to hold it to themselves. I was just sharing a while back, I'm dealing with one. He runs a 50 billion rated company, and he's 75 years old, and he doesn't want to let go. So there are different types of one. But the new entrepreneurs are different. You start up, set it up, sell it. Right? Sell it for a billion and then walk off to the next idea. So you need to ask yourself what type of one. But for any type of entrepreneurship, it's about having the right time. Okay? So let's just go ahead. So, culture. So I'll tell you, when I set up the first company, they call it an umbrella portal. So it was a travel portal, I said. So 25, 15 years ago, probably mid 95, 96, 97, around that period, exactly when the dot-com burst after that 5 years. So I set up. So first 30 days after I set it up, I thought I'm Superman, everything's going to be fine, I hire people, everything's ready. 30th day I felt like dying because I didn't get the funds. So you realize what your inspiration, your agency, your anxiety to start off is. changes that you go through, you know, all of that. And of course, as a resource, human capital, and as a resource, financial capital, people. You have the idea, everything belongs to you. So that was my biggest point. I realized that after that, I needed to make sure I have the people. But not, I'm not saying just 2-3 days, it's longer than that. The dream was longer than that. Long lasting dream I achieved. But by the end of that year, which was 1999, I secured 100 million. Okay? 100 million ringgit. We were operating in UK, Sri Lanka, Singapore, Malaysia, Australia. We were transacting about 500,000 a month, right? Bookings and transports and all that stuff. So I realized that if you continue like that, you won't last. 100 million will disappear very fast because we were on deficit. So we looked at people and I realized one, the next coordinating factor was collaboration. So we entered into partnership. We entered into partnerships with all the travel agents, travel companies, tour listed firms and so on. And it went through. So 2000, when everybody was either cashing out, you guys remember? In 2000, what were you doing? From 5? School? College? First year uni? First year. I feel so old already now. So I realized that that time was a time where we were really careful. So I started talking to VCs and others. What we realized was I had about 16 people looking for me. I wanted to make sure that they're taken care. If something happened, I walk out. I needed to have a succession plan. So I had, at the age of 26, I had 2 succession. So 2 other leaders to be, if I sell out and walk away, I had that ready. So it came to me, it dawned upon me that the dot-com was started in 2000. So everybody was cashing out, selling out and so on. But then you realize 4 years you were driving chauffeur-driven cars, burning cash, spending everything, and then you realize that you should have conserved certain things, build on talent. These 2 things was the lessons learned that I've during that period of time. I didn't have magic at that time. Come and tell me what needs to be done, where to guide you, where mistakes you can avoid, how you anticipate risks and so on. So by the end of the year, I sold. Somebody, that's it. But I realized that if I were to redo that again, it would be entirely different world. And I make sure I start with this first. Making sure we have talent. Okay? And have the right culture. Culture here means a set of beliefs. Every organization has got a set of beliefs. And when you start up an organization, you have a set of beliefs. You want to keep in mind their assumptions. And remember, it doesn't stay put, it evolves. So, as you are evolving, it also evolves. As your businesses grow, it evolves. So, don't underestimate culture, because once you start 1 employee, 2 employee, 100 employees, it changes. It's an organism by itself. So, that set of beliefs, assumptions that you, or values that you build, you want to make sure that you will allow it to evolve. Okay? You see Scott Adams, Gilbert say, what does he say? I've decided to make some changes in the corporate culture. It's a very interesting joke. How people observe his decision. So imagine you are this person and you're saying I want to change. Look at what's the first assumption. The first assumption, people begin to start assuming things. Even the word culture can mean different things to different people. And you want to make sure the foundation is addressed carefully. Right? All the assumptions go through all the way. And you see at the end of the day what the guy who started to talk about changing culture says. I wonder if it's too late to rule by fear now. goes around all the way and comes back to square one. And the people sitting around the table are the people who are going to make things happen for you. Your coding, your coders, your programmers, your marketing people, your sales people, your liaison, your partners, building partnerships and so on, right? So when you are from a startup point of view and a established organization, what's the key differences to looking at? Okay. So you're looking at the culture being built by a starting group of employees. I'm going to tell you what we cannot do as well in a while. So you're talking about this founder's personality alignment, actually. Does it make sense to those who have, you have started? They align with you? No, they hate you? It's okay. That's also an alignment, but they call, I call it disalignment. Right? Sometimes as a startup you think you are the owner, you drive things, you say it's this way or the highway. Encourage to be flexible, dynamic in your approach with them. Allow them to take cumulative responsibility. I call it collective and continuous responsibility. Okay? And you're also making sure that performance is there. There is a measure of performance. You need to have a performance measure so that they see progress. And when you compare it to something which is already established, can you see the changes? Size of the organization, level, position. More job-specific functions, which doesn't allow you to be flexible. And likely you have to take time to drive it across an organization like ours. For example, we have 17,000 employees, 52 countries. By the time I say one message here, it gets across to China, the message already changed. Right? I say yes, they say no. I send a message to India, I don't know whether they say yes or no. It's okay. It's a cultural thing. So you have to respect that. So today you're talking about Malaysia. So what's the Malaysian cultural norms? Malaysian time. Right. First is Malaysian time. What is it called? There's a code name for that. Are you guys aware? Them said something to do with elastic time. Drags and drags. And of course, OTW. On the way. Right? On the way. I'm sitting in the car. I haven't even started. Alright? So, as you continue, what are the other things? As entrepreneurs that you need to be aware of. You're hiring somebody, right? What are the first few things that you experienced as an entrepreneur? Those who have started. Anyone has got more than 10 employees? Okay. 5 employees? Okay. It's okay. 2 employees? Okay. 2, you got 2. So you want to say what was your experience in hiring? Why I say is this is your start balance. As you're building your culture, you need to make sure you have these quadrants as part of that. And it's very, very important. If you ask me, I can talk 1 hour on each of this topic. And the reason why I say that is in your cultural statement that you're going to prepare for your startup, for your dream, for your venture, you want to make sure that these elements are covered. Not all, it can be a set, a few. Okay. But it gives you an example of what needs to be done. How do you associate with your vision? How do you associate with engaging your people, your partners, the community that you're connected to? How do you influence them? How do you build a sense of urgency? Tangibility. That means they need to see what you're doing, right? As an entrepreneur, sometimes you have a very nice dream. You sleep well, what a great idea, next day morning you come and say that idea, and then they all look at you and say, which side of the bed did you get up from? But it's the point, it's in your visual, it is a dream. But you know you can make it up, but can they? Can they make it up? This is what helps you make it up. And then the cornerstone is culture. That is your... Do you remember migrating birds? Why do they find that culture? Do you remember? The V shape? It's called team velocity. The term, team velocity. So the bird, in the first bird, the leading bird, breaks there. Because there's pressure which is coming on, it breaks it so the rest of them can fly without pressure on them. Alright? But then it gets tired. Do you know how often they shift positions? So the first bird which is leading shifts positions, so the next bird goes up. So sometimes it's not enough that you can get tired too. Right? So what keeps you going is culture. And then how it's connected with all the elements, I call it the touchstone elements. So keep this in your mind as part of your exercise when you build the entire entrepreneur mindset. Okay. So how do you look at it from a startup? Why do big companies continue to hire? I mean, or acquire small companies? Or acquire startups? Have you thought about that? New ideas, the ideation process, it's fresh, the culture is fresh, you want to acquire so that your large dinosaur organization can feel some of those aspects to it. So if you're planning to start up something, making it really successful very fast, you know who to sell to. The large dinosaurs. Right? So look at the jokes we are talking about. Foster startup culture. So can you see the mindset of people? So if you're a startup, I can dress any way I want. You define it. As an entrepreneur, you define it. I know organizations where you can be in a collared t-shirt, jeans, 24/7. But assume you're going to a bank to sell your idea. If you go with a t-shirt and jeans, will you get the loan? Come on, I did that, I tried. You'll have to wait outside. But you go in a suit, they walk you in. This is a fact, guys. Perception. So you need to keep in mind, startup perception is one thing. As a big organization, it's another thing. Alright? How do you name it? How do you name it is how you define it. So you know how to arrange, adjust, position yourself. I've talked to bankers. I know what are the set of points they have for each of the decisions they have. They have a formula. So let me quickly ask a question. Entrepreneurs, how many of you got loans in your first attempt? How many of you got loans? At least after many attempts? No? Today you have many channels, right? You can advertise, you can use referrals, right? Okay? So, a lot more channels available to you to be able to gone. So you can take advantage of all the channels. And I'm also hearing today we can do it in MaGIC. You've got a network. You've got a huge network of like-minded people that you can talk to, you can work with. Why not? This is the congregation of a social entrepreneurship center that you should take advantage of. Be here more often, find out what are the events which is going on. Today is a group, I mean, all of you can connect with each other, find out how many of you can work together. Even if you compete collaboratively. Compete collaboratively. Where do you think? Hit each other, kill each other, work with each other. There's so many ways to do that. Right? So look at that consideration as part of your selection process. Then you have to make an offer, a formal offer to the person. And make sure that once the position is filled, you recognize the person, bring this on. Treat it like an organization 5 years, which is going to be 5 years from now. Treat the employee part of that journey. Don't go and tell me it's a small company, so you can do whatever you want. The moment, you know, what I meant was, the way you set the standards and culture starts from day one. Okay. So once you set it, it's an opportunity for you. Right? So what are the things you have to avoid? So hiring mistakes startups should avoid. Okay, the first thing of course we know, don't rush. Don't rush to hire, make sure you think through very carefully before you hire. Don't hire your spouse, friends or family members, your girlfriends, anyone, your boyfriends. You need to make sure you separate. It's painful. They will be interested to be part of your exciting idea because that's the time your creative juices are coming out. You sold the idea to them. They said, can I also work with you? That's the time you need to draw the line. Sorry guys, this is separate. Life is separate. Work is separate. Draw the line. It's easy, they say it's integrating, but it's not. You will lose your objectivity when you have friends or family inside. It's painful, but it's a fact. Okay? Then you're talking about top-down hiring. Encourage the people to refer. You remember your first hire? Talk to the first hire who's inspired by being part of your company to refer someone. Start from there. If that person is hesitating to refer somebody to you, then you should be worried. That's a fact. It's your test. Yeah. And then you're going to talk about partner. Now if you're thinking about it already. The partner you hire. Please make sure you pay professional. Once you agree, standards, agreements are in place. Whatever agreements you might have in terms of share equity or whatever, keep that in place. Because at some point it's going to come back and bite you. There's a tendency you want to hire one person who can do everything. Right? Islamic. One person who can do everything in the company. It's not possible. You will be that person. Sorry, you have to take it hard on me. You will be that person who will do everything. But that person you're going to hire is going to be staying focused on what area you want. That's how you work. There's a tendency to push it down and say, hey, I'm busy today, can you do that? So you're going to add unnecessary undue duress to that person. And you lose focus, that person also loses focus. So if you will have to take the responsibility to do everything because you're a startup, you're one employee, let that person stay focused on your objectives that you define. Make sense? Alright, so as you progressively grow, how do you hire, how do you attract people and retain people? Any one of you in the business of voluntary? No. Voluntary is only in social service, right? You got something? An idea? Go ahead. So, if you can't volunteer, you cannot get volunteers. Sometimes you may need Yeah, I'm not saying you don't need to pay them, but you need some form of support externally. No man is an island now. So you need to make sure that you have some kind of voluntary support. You need to build a sort of social network. A network that you can depend on for some things. They could be your prospective partners. Right? So who are these people? Who would these people be in your mind? Who can be your volunteers? College students. You think they're going to come back and work for you and get anything?
Family.
Family, yes. Good.
Best friend.
Friends. So if you notice, I didn't say you're the higher the one. I said volunteer. Let them volunteer. You need that extra support when you need it and when you don't have the funds. You have to have a pool of volunteers. They have to buy into your idea. And you can appreciate them in different forms. I've heard of stories where in my difficult times when I set up the firm, there were people who helped me. So I came back to them. Of course, they wouldn't want to help. I still remember. I was living in Namatsara, couldn't afford a car at that time because I was putting everything into the business. There was this gentleman who I met in the apartment area. We became friends. By the way, he's one of the chief marketing officers of the largest media in Malaysia, of the largest media. So we were probably starting our career at that point and he knew I was setting the business. So, we used to wait for LRT. That's how we became friends. We started working and so on. Later, when he could afford a car, so he'll come by and he'll look at me waiting there. He'll say, come, hop on. So there are things which I used to work with him. And I used to tell him all the ideas. He's the sounding board. He used to tell me from a media aspect what can he do and so on. So he also got me the first press conference. Alright? This is someone not moving into anything, someone who lives in the apartment in the next block. So you never know who's going to help you, and they can be a volunteer. Right? So later, at some point in his career, he wanted to change. He was part of a band, so he came and told me, I'm fed up, I want to move. So I helped him into another organization. That was my way of being. Till today we are in touch. We kept in touch. So he's in the media firm, doing really well. Anything I need, I make one phone call, media address. I'm just giving you one real idea, one inspirational idea that we have that you can build on family and friends. Build on that as a volunteer, but please don't forget to pay back. Okay. I use the term pay back. You need to give them back. It doesn't need to be just money. Kind in other ways, people need to feel appreciated. Sometimes they are your ladder. Climb on them and then push them off. Alright, so coming back to attraction, there are different ways you can attract talent in your organization. From the first talent you hire, how do you build on it? How do you build to the next? Use their referral system, which is the fastest way to build it. Referral is the fastest when you start. You don't need to advertise, unless you've got a venture fund. VC funding, they say, advertise, I'll give you a blank check. I don't think so it happens anymore. Word of mouth. Word of mouth. Okay, that's another channel that you need to use. So one successful person, one LinkedIn message, you go in, give your comments. Share the comments, social media experts. Use that. Okay. Retain. You don't need to have a challenger retention because you're starting up. You're looking at one talent or two employees in your team. You want to stay close with them. Understand them better. Be closer with them. You should know how to appreciate them for the little things and bigger things. Their birthdays and all those things. Celebrate together, have fun. Then you can build on it. automatically then culture continues. So while you are attracting talent, you have different types of talent now, right? For the first time, you have four types of generations. So you have the Southern generation, who are probably 60s and above, baby boomers in the 40s to 60s, and then you have Generation X, which is your 30s and 40s. Are you guys in your 30s? Yes, so you're Gen X. And then you have 18 to 29. Anyone in the less than 29? Less than 30? 1, 2, 3. Okay, you guys are 10. Why? You guys are the most hated people in the world. Don't you know that? So people talk about you every day, abuse you every day, right? So, but you guys are going to be the most influential people in the next 10 years. So all the X, please watch out. They will form the 50% of the most powerful working population in the next 10 years. So this is the kind of people you need to hire. So let me ask you a question. You have to hire only people who are younger than you. Okay. You can hire similar generation as well. But have you thought of hiring senior people? Depending on the position. Good. Depending on other categories as well, right? So I'm going to shift your thought process a little bit. Because unfortunately today you have a notion where young people are more active. They can do things better. So you go to an organization and say, it's higher in the 20s or the 30s. I mean, I'm part of an American company now. If I go and tell them that I want to hire my age, they'll sue me. But in Malaysia, you can do anything. You can advertise anything also. But as an entrepreneur, I'm inviting you to set the standard. So you look for the right people, irrespective of the age. And I will tell you real life scenario. So when I came to the company 12 years ago, this particular group, after I was retrenched, after I sold my .com. So I realized that they were in the entry level experience group. So I came in and I said, what about the senior experience? You see, you cannot buy experience. And we needed experience. When you go to a client, they want to see experience people with you. It's okay. But that experience should add value to you and the business. So I hired 35 people in the age of 65. Everybody in the company called me unorthodox. But what did I do? I talked to them, they said they are retired. So I asked them, what do you do? I said, I was an HR director who retired. I was the CEO, I was retired. I cannot sit at home. They came back and told me. So I said, how would you like to work with me? I said, I would like to work with you like a partner. I don't want to be an employee, but I like to be a partner. I said, no problem. I said, partner. I said, not the big man. I said, respect me like a partner. So how can you help me? So whenever you need a particular service, I can come and advise you and your client. And you pay a nominal fee. So they were not on my payroll. They were consultants. So I brought them in. They have worked with me since. I treat them with a lot of respect. It's very important. 65 in average age. Men and women. I would like you to tap onto their talent sitting outside. Here, right in Malaysia. In the next 5 years, we will become an aging nation. Which means 15% of our population will reach retirement age. And it's so difficult for you to hire people, right? Why don't you consider them as part of that working relationship with consultants? You might have any relationship with the bank. You might have a relationship with the government. Healthy working partnership elsewhere. That experience is something you cannot get. You can get a young talent who can run around and do things, but experience-wise is not there. So consider this group of people as well. Okay? It's important as you are, as an entrepreneur, you're looking at all types of talent for you. So all age groups also, all levels of experience also matters. Okay. Today you have cloud technology. Cloud computing, which allows you to have a building, accounting system, everything online, right? So you don't need an accountant per se. But you need, when you're filing your company returns, you need to go there. So you can work with the co-sell, shared services. You can get it done, it's okay. It's a very reasonable price. Office space is available here, and I think incubation centers are available. So you can take benefit of that, take advantage of it. Or work from home, it's okay. How many of you work from home? It's quite okay. It's most comfortable now, okay. But if you go to a bank, does your office, your house, does it work? Some challenges there, right? So you need to be prepared for where you work. Where you work today is just a concept. Work as a workplace is no more existing. You are carrying it wherever you go. It's in Kopitiam, it's in Starbucks, that's your office. But perception to the corporate, to the partner, to the bank, to everybody else, it's different. That's why most of the startups, where do they start from? From the backyard. It does, but as you progress, you can move forward. The idea is you need to have an address. You need to work through the development as well. So people need to see the different type of workforce. They need to see how they appreciate you. I'm working with an age group. Who's in the 20s, who's in the 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s. I'm not going to tell you it's easy, as it is not. You need to set an expectation with each one. Once you set an expectation with a different age group, it's going to happen, depending on what need you have. Okay? But remember the example I gave you, a partner, friend, alati, volunteer. There's so many stories there. Tell you. Alright? And these are people, everyone matters to you during this journey. So not only hiring, but partnering as well. So look at it from a different angle. Okay? I'm not going to go through this, I think they will give you.
People here, okay,
as in next to you. You should have that. That's all hidden inside, you know. Okay. So it is, they call it obsessive compulsive disorder. It's in. You cannot take it out, but you have to learn to let it go at some point, otherwise it's just too destructive for others. Okay, so from a general angle, preferred employer organization size. I'm just giving you a perspective of how organizations look at it. If you see preferred employer organization size, what type of company do you most prefer to work for? As an employee, somebody wants to work for you here. Who wants to work for another set of organizations? There's three areas you're looking at. Small businesses, large company, mid-size, and local friends. I like you to look at this group. Mid-size, right? And then you see the local friends. You see this? What does that tell you? This particular group does have no preference in terms of size of the company. They are the ones you need to look for. They're inspired by startups, new entities, new growth companies. And likewise, if you look at this, are they looking for established firms, local friends, Fortune 500, startups? So you see a startup group is very small, but then you look at no preference. So you need to bridge that gap between the type of organizations and how do you look at it? Between the size of the company and how long have they been established. Today they announced the top 5 companies Malaysians would like to work for. You guys aware? Any guesses who's the top 5 companies? Today, announcement went out. Media. Sorry? Dillon. No, not on the list. Malaysia. Petronas, yes. That's the first. Everybody wants to go to Petronas. They can hire only 45,000 people, which they're full by the way. They've hired already 45,000. Do you know how many graduates come out? 300,000 plus come out. But then they only have 1,000 jobs max in a year. Not possible. Who are the rest of the 5?
Sambhavi,
yes. Google, yes. Correct. Sambhavi is there, Google is there, Pranas is there. Is there any startup? So can I challenge you to be that startup that people like to work? Somebody has to challenge you, okay? You guys like challenges. Take that up. Make that small place. It's not about big place. Huh? I know I've seen social entrepreneurs who can have, who rent a space in a restaurant. Table of 5 or 10 with internet, they rent it. And that is the office. They do everything from there, a small quarter of the place in a restaurant. So it's up to you how you want to do it. You can talk to your university, ask them for one classroom where 4 of you can go. You can talk to MaGIC, find out what are the things we can do here. So many avenues are there. If you don't ask, you don't get it. Right? Okay, so this is the size of the organization perspective as well as the how long we have established. I'll give you the perspective so that you know how to take your journey, enjoy your journey, and so on. Ideal work environment, and this is based on ideal worker work environment. So when asked the question, what is your ideal work environment? By region, they've stated the top 4 features. The first and topmost for APAC, if you see, is the purple color. They say highly collaborative environment. So if you are hiring people, you need to have a collaborative mindset. So if you're hiring somebody who says, leave me alone, I do it by myself, it's not going to work. You need to have someone who can work with people and work well. So a couple of questions I would ask them is, what's supposed to be. They are part of a team here, it's going to help you build a position. Do they help any? Are they working in extracurricular activities? Have they been in any team events? And all those things are going to help. Second, so the second is in terms of how they look at flexibility. Okay, now as a startup you can give flexibility. So what is flexibility? I don't need to come to office for a month, can I? Flexible work arrangements. Just flexibility, which means if I can I work from home? Multinational firm? Possible. My organization? Possible. Small enterprise? No. You don't come, you don't have to leave. If I can't see you, I don't know whether you're doing work. It's true. Okay, before starting your business, has any one of you worked? Worked. Have you felt that at one point? The level of distrust? I was sitting in front of your eyes and I was working. Yeah, you were sitting in front of me, you were on the Facebook all the time. Exposure to latest technology. If you don't have a technology-enabled company, it's going to be very tough. So even if you have a small cubicle, you want to make sure you have everything ready. Culture of innovation and creativity. Allow people to challenge you. Encourage them. But as an entrepreneur, sometimes it's testing, right? You keep asking questions. You know, do you work? You know, that kind of challenges are there. Allow them to challenge within that time frame they have. When you have a meeting, discuss, challenge each other. Don't fix it. If not, what happens is they continue to challenge, they disturb everything. But you allow challenge time, allow innovation time. Give them that time frame. So in 1 hour in a day, you want to talk about it, you've got new ideas, they prepare for it and come. Then they can come and challenge you with something. It's okay if only two of you are there. You can set that time and you can do that. It works. So I tell my team, it's okay for you to challenge me, but if you want to insult me in public, don't do it. Come to my room and you insult me. You know, they are really upset with you, right? They want to tell you off. I said, no, come to the room. Close the door and you shout. Sometimes our vice president is your SLA, 1,000 people working for you. If you tell them that, they are shocked. By you telling them that, they won't do that again with you. But you want to encourage the Asian mindset, you need to bring them. People don't want to talk to the boss. First of all, they don't even want to talk to the boss. How do you expect them to go and shout at the boss? Right? But you need to encourage them. But tell them there is a discipline, a decorative. So when they challenge you, they can. But if they want to test you really hard, do it in private. You want to do it with a team and so on, with others, it's possible. Yesterday, I just shared with you, what I did was I brought a university entrepreneur, someone who's working with a university. Right? He set up a partnership with the university, has an office there, uses their facility. Wanted to work with us. So he brought his team and I brought my team. We discussed about collaboration. I was surprised talking to him about the frustrations he's had in the last 3 years after having set up the company. It wasn't easy. He was a graduate of the same university, requested the university, submitted a proposal, awarded the grant, set up the office, but he could not get it through. So what was his challenge? So he told me, I need, five seasons. What are the 5 seasons? Cash, credit card,
car,
condo. Spicy, fifth season.
Credit cards.
Say credit cards, okay?
Cash.
Okay, so we're talking about M's. You're selling manpower, money power. Muscle and influence to get things done. So I asked him, what is that? There are so many little Napoleons everywhere, he said. So I said, what do you mean by little Napoleons? Have you heard of that term? Anyone familiar with little Napoleons? Oh my God. You guys have a long way to go now. And you want to be entrepreneurs now. Anyone knows what's little Napoleon? Anyone wants to take a guess? I have to tell you guys, if you don't know this, it's going to be tough, you know. Idea? Sorry? No, no need to conquer. These are the guys who don't let you conquer. You have a great idea. You have a great plan. You submit it to an organization, right? Get an approval, a division of what you want to do. You'll just change the cover page of your company, put another company. Now you're waking up. Okay, just be alert for the little Napoleons. They're there everywhere. But as you rise up, the ranks and the change and the growth that you are taking place right now, you may be wanting to be prepared for. How many of you plan to work with the government by any chance? I mean, joint venture, partnerships, or anything? 1, 2, 3, 4. Watch out for this little Napoleons. I mean, they're invisible, by the way.
Sorry, I can't get
you.
What do you mean by
this? Okay. This is controversial, okay? So if you're working in government, let's say you're bidding for a project, okay? There is something called the closed tender. I'm being recorded, okay? So I'm going to be very careful now. So I'll be very diplomatic in my response. Privately, I'll tell you everything. But when you bid for a project, there's a close and over a bid. Right? So during this period of time, anything can happen. Okay? So if you are alert, you should be able to manage this process. So there are some individuals who can disrupt your chance. Okay? That's what I meant. Can you sue them? They're invisible. How can you find them and sue them? But you need to be alert, be anticipate such scenarios so that you know what needs to be done. I've gone through that. It's painful, so I need to make sure I let you know. They told me share it from the heart, everything. So I'm going to share it as it is. Okay? So, as you're growing, I'm going to keep this line of sight for you to grow. Line of sight to growth is very important because you need to dream big. So yesterday I was with CEO of a 80 billion ringgit company. So you might have already guessed who this is. How many 80 billion ringgit companies are in Malaysia? Come on, guys. That's your general knowledge. Okay, it's in Bursa. Go and find out later. Okay, so I had an opportunity to talk to this person and he was telling me something very interesting. He said, you need to be an uncontrollable stallion. So I asked him, what do you mean by uncontrollable stallion? What does it mean? I mean, horses, right? They run fast, they run, but he said uncontrollable. As you start up enterprises, you need to have the ideation and growth plans. Okay? In an uncontrollable, chaotic mode. It's better than being a donkey, he said. Where you have to beat the donkey every day to get ideas or movement. So his analogy behind it was to drive that inspiration to the team, you need to be that stallion. That driving that energy to the team, into yourself, into your partner, into everybody else. Sometimes you feel demotivated, disturbed. Right? There are chances. So you can't afford that. You have to be self-motivated, self-driven. You need to keep driving them all the time. So he said, be there to always drive. That's when you begin to drive the leadership attributes. You drive the growth attributes which you cannot see. Sometimes you cannot see, but you need to keep driving that. You don't know how far you will go unless you try and be that uncontrollable step. Okay. So, talking about growth, this is the hockey stick growth. So, how many startups fail in the first 2 years?
Many.
Give me a percentage.
25?
Do you think about it? I don't have a magic answer for that, a magic formula for that as well. But what I know from my experience is having the right people, having the right resources, conserving as much as conserve cash, have sufficient volunteers, have sufficient partners. All of these are part of that ecosystem for you to sustain. You know very well what you have entered into. I'm not creating any fear. If you ask me, I will any day become an entrepreneur again. Any day, I'll just talk to it and I will start. That's me. It's inside of me that I'm comfortable telling. So I talked to my company, they made me an intrapreneur. And this is what they did. They gave me 100,000 ringgit and told me to make it into a $1 million. 100,000 ringgit, that's all. They gave me two people. I can only give you two. I give you 100,000 ringgit. But at the end of 12 months, you are giving 1 million ringgit. It's a fact, guys. 2001. Two people, failing business unit, 100,000 ringgit cash, okay, to fund that. 1 million ringgit. They said, if you make it, come back, we'll make you happy. Understand what's making me happy now. So all I realized was just kidding them. So I talked to the two people, one was an assistant manager, one was a consultant. I said, okay guys, 1 million, 12 months time, work backwards. So in a year, how many days are active days? 200 days, right? So 200 active days, waking hours, so much, in terms of engaging with people. So 5 days, 20 days in a month, approximately, you start connecting. So what we did was we worked backwards. We looked at the companies that we need to engage with, the people we need to talk to. How do we ensure that we keep the CRM active? How do we make sure we meet people to trust you and the people business? So we connected. How do we make sure that kind of creative idea came? 2001, who thinks of tenders and bids for people business? So I just said, okay, let's go to a company, let's put in a bid. So we participate in the bid. December 27th, you were awarded. It took me 12 months literally to get that money. Have you got it? So from there, they gave me 30 million over there. So we considered. When I gave it back to them, it was about 300 million US business. It took me 12 years to build that. So that journey is an over a period of journey, not a time. I know you're wondering, this is a dot-com company, you sold it out, they don't really want it. No, it's a big business. They set it up, they ran solutions and building it out and so on. So today they continue to treat me as an entrepreneur. They give me a country or a region or a practice area and ask me to commercialize it within 90 days. So that's why you have to be very careful. Earlier you do it in 12, they reduce the period to 6 and then they reduce to 3. But if you have the passion, right people that have. You cannot do it alone. Always remember that you need to build an ecosystem around you as an entrepreneur. So that is why the objective of talent-driven organization is important. So some of the things you may want to keep in mind is workforce planning. This is a text-heavy slide. I have not been making text-heavy slides. But just for you to know that it's important for you to build a plan. As you progress, they're going to ask you. They're going to ask you a 5-year plan, right? Banks will ask you. So you need to tell them, projected what needs to be done, what needs to go in as part of workforce planning. sure people you're hiring, what is the level of contribution of each of these resources, and what do they cost you, and what's the return you're expecting from them as well. So, just to give you from a visual impact, as you're starting, there's two aspects to this. You're building an individual value, or you're building short-term results, matching, and the business value as well. But what is key is for you to build this track, career, leadership, key roles. You need to chart this five-year plan as part of your business goal. I'm going to pause for a moment here, just to get any questions or thoughts that you might have. As you dreamt, I'm sure in your dream and in your idea, you would have thought about 5 years, 10 years, am I right? No, my dream is only about today. Huh? Anyone thought about how you visualize 5 years from now, where would you be? Anyone bold enough to share it with everyone? Come on guys, I know it's Friday afternoon and we are not in TGIF. So you need to come up with an idea. Now, I need one of you to come up and tell me, I dread, this is what I think. It's okay, it can be absurd. It can be absurd, it can be stupid, whatever it is, it doesn't really matter. But, yeah, you are crazy. You have an idea. Share it with the group, make it public. Only then you can, you know.
We are offering
a share option.
Thank you.
Good, thank you. not a place for you to be shy. Okay, sir. There's a reason why I'm asking this, because as you're building this, you have rightly pointed out, you told about lack of talent, right? Lack of programmers. Both of you are promoting it, but as in promoters of the company, but you do not have the sufficient talent. Probably it's across the board, right? And I hear about a similar scenario. But you have some form of challenges from that. So you need to build a self-related system, promote about this. Let me ask you a question. Are you guys connected with each other? No? Are we having a networking session after that? Maybe we can arrange some array or something like that. I mean, you, all of you put together, it's probably a collective entrepreneur group already.
Networking.
And if there's a way we can help people who are seeking job opportunities out there, we can create it. I'm the business of talent. We place 25,000 people a year in Malaysia. 1 million people around the world. Every 6 seconds we place a person in the world. So imagine what are the things we can do. So, video, hotel, anyone else? I know you were waiting. Yes, there's a portal there. So they can come back and give you the best price. And you can give the work to them.
Can they really do that?
Yes. Absolutely. I have done work with them. But you go by the ranking. Because they give you the ranking of who's the best, and coding, who's the least, and so on. I think it's a perfect place to be. And it's nice for entrepreneurs where you don't need to spend money, but you can do coding work.
So a lot of companies come there and then realize that they are already
can't build foundation and then go and dig up and see what needs to be done later. So, suggestions as you build your ideation, incorporate the value strategy. Okay, this is a different angle. Relocation, I was thinking that this group might have movement, relocation, globally integrated activities. So we presume your business is going to other countries.
Good.
So you need talent in other countries. So you need to build a certain level of plan for relocation. Somebody from Malaysia going across, somebody from elsewhere coming in. You need to build that process as part of your talent mindset. Some of the policies, procedures for short-term, permanent, long-term transfers. It's important to keep in mind because today, in order to bring in some talent, you need to have a set of processes. You might get an excellent talent from, say, Eastern Europe. Or you might get from South America, or any other part of Australia, Africa, anywhere. But how do you make sure you're able to come in and add value? That while they are listening or working or for and vice versa. For you to go into another country, what are those things that you need to do from a talent angle as well? So when you reach a mature state, I'm taking you through the journey. So a mature state here talks about that you have a talent mapping process, a talent acquisition process, from an international relocation, management, alignment, local regulation, legislation, good supply chain, and segmentation. This is your future. I think probably I'm ahead of the headlines. I've gone ahead of the headlines, but just an idea for you to show the path. Sometimes you haven't thought through, you might have learned to be, but you need to think through the processes also to go so on. Okay, this is a typical talent management cycle. What are the steps which is involved? We have to just keep in mind how do you plan, promote, set expectations with them, performance management, I highlighted earlier to you. How do you engage with them? Get them ready for tomorrow's work. How do you deploy them, redeploy them? And finally, how do you leverage them? Okay? Right, so this is the general cycle of talent management. And by the way, this itself is a 1 week class. Just giving you a glimpse. This is the supply chain. This is a new concept Kelly is driving as an organization. We are building the points of analytics. And I would like you to seriously look at this as an entrepreneur. Look at temporary workers. Because you don't need programming for an entire cycle. Once it's done, you don't need the person after that. It's okay. So hire them on a temporary basis. Independent contractors and freelancers, I would strongly encourage you to create this and build this community of freelancers who can come and do work for you. And you pay them, they're done. Okay? But make sure they're trustworthy. Service providers, now you know that you can't hire, afford to hire. Work with a company which can do that for you. They can do coding work, complete the work for you at a reasonable price. That those are your SOW. And remember I talked about retirees. I forgot interns. They're not cheap labor. Smart people. Bring them on. Small companies. You can take them. Give them that 3 months experience. They can work with you. They understand what they're doing. They can add value to you. Right? And you're talking about retirees as well. You want to make sure that you reach out to them where they can add value to you, sure. And of course, full-time. The traditional full-time permanent workers, which everybody wants permanent work. But guess what? Every 18 months they leave. So why do you call it permanent job? I told them, I'll give you 18 months contract. They said, no, I want the job. I said, I want permanent job. Are you going to be there permanently? I give you a contract later, but no, no, permanent job. But that cannot be earned in this day. So the mindset, today's generation, workforce generation, current employee base, they will not be in the age group, and it is 12 to 18 months. They quit. They move to another company. It's very frustrating to clients. Very frustrating. So why don't you give them a freelancer job or a contract job? So you don't need to go through a lot of investment and then start doing the process. Consider workforce analytics and strategic workforce planning as part of your future plans. As you grow, maybe all of you form a consortium. Different groups of people are here, all of you have some ideas, you can put together and so on. How do you build them? Typically, you are looking at operations, human resources, human in every organization, so you will have one as well. But for now, you are a person. You are the operations, HR, so you need to understand that your roles is key for them to execute that area as well. Now, a lot of people are scared to talk about this. When you grow a business, you also need to prepare to downsize or change when you go through a change. Does it make sense? So a lot of people give importance only when you grow. And then when the project is over, when you want to say goodbye to the people, and they say, oh, so, you know, I don't want to say goodbye. Retrenchment, termination, replacement. So you need to be comfortable with that. So you need to be prepared when you rise. You add, at some point you need to make change. And in order to make change, you need to be comfortable. That when change happens, how do you ensure that it's done with dignity? If you worked in a company, any one of you by any chance were retrenched before? Retrenched, outplaced? Yes. Contract. So you haven't had a chance to contract getting over or something. Yeah, I was retrenched before. It's not an easy feeling. It's a very difficult feeling. Work there, you keep all your life, and then suddenly it's done. Alright, so we're coming to the final few slides, just making sure that all of you are there. Usually this is a guideline. I talk through the ideas, so I get your input, so you're familiar with what's happening. This is a full cycle. So you remember we started with culture. When you acquire talent, you need to acquire the right culture. When you engage talent, you are driving performance. When you develop talent, you are building value for your organization. When you transition, you are building mobility. It means you move one person to one role to another role, or when you move one person from one country to another country, you want to keep in mind all of this. Alright? So these are the fundamentals of the entire talent management philosophy. Okay? Right, so that's about it from me. Okay. Questions?
Okay, thank you, Anthony. Any questions? Give us the hardest questions. We have a VP in the house. Any questions?
How soon do you want to start planning to hire people? Because as you start out,
okay. You're looking at a scale of growth. So you have a plan to grow. One of the things I would encourage entrepreneurs to do or startup entities to do is look at a 3 to 5 year plan, definitely, as part of your phase one. You need to know when you need to commercialize anything that you have had. Okay, and there is a commercial success time frame. Remember the umbrella portal, travel portal, I said, 1996, 97, 98, 99. There are only a 4 year life. Today's technology is so advanced, some of what you might create now will have only 2 to 4 years left. Unless you innovate and you develop, or you commercialize and you sell it. So you need to understand the compressed time frame that you're going through. So due to the compression now, and the urgency to hire, you need to look at that plan and put that perspective inside. But in the perspective of manpower planning, I would recommend you to consider the type of manpower as well. Remember temporary contract permanent? As you scale up, you don't need to hire full-time anymore. In the past, you have to consider full-time, but now you don't need to reserve resources as much as you can. And keep the risk limitation as very small as possible. So full-time, as small as possible. Temporary workers? Freelancers, you can scale up and down. So based on your demand, you utilize it. It's available out there anyway. Okay.
Any questions? I have a question. If public jobs are something that is not